Hello, I'm Katie Jarvis, and this week, Reelfoot Forward is made possible by our friends at William Sausage, the home of authentic country goodness and family-owned and operated since 1958, right here in Tennessee. Welcome to Reelfoot Forward from Discovery Park of America, located up here in the corner of beautiful West Tennessee. Every day at our museum and heritage park, we inspire children and adults to see beyond. And each week, we do the same thing here on our podcast. In today's episode, Scott sits down with Kelley Powers from Final Flight Outfitters. They discuss Kelley's early success in the professional goose calling world, how he and his brothers built a huge business from the ground up, and his humanitarian efforts. Stick around afterwards and listen to what Andrew Gibson discovers as we go behind the scenes at Discovery Park of America.
Hello, I'm Scott Williams, host of Reelfoot Forward, where each week we celebrate our little section of the South as we explore the culture, the spirit, the accomplishments, and the heritage of our home here in West Tennessee. This week, we have a world champion as our guest. At the tender age of 21, Kelley Powers had already won the World Goose Calling Championship and the World Goose Champion of Champions. And then he retired from that event and went on to win the international contest, followed by the Masters, not the golf, but the goose calling, the World Open, and later the Worldwide. This is a feat that has never been achieved by any other individual alive. Now, instead of calling geese, Kelley is calling customers to visit Final Flight Outfitters, Inc. in Union City, Tennessee, a business that Kelley and his two brothers, Jon Ed and Tripp, built from the ground up. Kelley is not just a successful goose caller and entrepreneur. His accomplishments include an award started in his name, the Kelley Powers Humanitarian Award, that is given yearly by the Live for a Cure Foundation to individuals that display outstanding outdoor humanitarian efforts. Kelley was also recognized by the governor of Tennessee, the state senate, and the state house of representatives, honoring him for his accomplishments and work with Tennessee's youth. Welcome, Kelley.
Great, man. That's a long intro.
You have accomplished a lot in your young years here on Earth. We're going to definitely talk about the goose calling and all that in just a minute. But first of all, give me a little overview of what Final Flight Outfitters. Of course, I've been there many times. I really love it. But tell folks listening what they would find at Final Flight Outfitters.
We started Final Flight basically off our passion of the outdoors and passion of hunting. Me, Jon, and Tripp grew up in a farm family, so agricultural and hunting kind of goes hand in hand. You know, we're in the fields in the summertime, and in the fall and winter, you're not necessarily as much in the fields, but you can go hunting. And so we took that passion. And we had some friends in the outdoor industry that we started selling their products and representing them at outdoor shows. So in the summer months, that, you know, inventory kind of got placed in storage and warehouse and all that, and then we would bring it out during the season or during hunting season. So that's how Final Flight started. It literally, from a ground roots standpoint, it started out of a storage trailer where we had all of the equipment and the inventory, and then we started with seasonal hours at our physical storefront, and we had a little mail order catalog, and we just took baby steps from there. And we're so fortunate to be in Northwest Tennessee. It's a great community, giving community. I mean, we take a lot of pride of the small town business, of knowing our customers really well, knowing what products they like, and that interaction. You know, the days of catalogs and mail order and internet shopping is a tough tackle. And we have a vast website presence, and we're there as well. But you miss out on a shopping experience and interaction one on one with a customer, you know, that you don't get, you know, online. So we try to just stock our shelves with a lot of products for the hunter and outdoorsman and let them make a good decision. So yes, they can buy it online, but they can go to Final Flight and spend 2 or 3 hours and compare that product with other products in its same area. And we would think, you know, hopefully they'd make a good decision and be happy with what they have.
Yeah, I loved your website. There's your statement, sort of, I guess, part of your mission statement, but, you know, it's basically Final Flight Outfitters will always be advocates of personal relationships with their customers.
That's correct.
You know, I think that contributes a great deal to your success as an organization.
With our staff, we use kind of the term see it, feel it, touch it, experience it, and you can't really get that shopping online. And like I said, we have an online presence, but when you can go in there, you can see the product, you can feel the product, you can touch it, see what it's made of, and then you can experience the engagement with a person behind the counter and maybe both of y'all, and you can learn more about the product and get educated on different things. You just don't experience that online. And what we see is a lot of people will drive 3, 4, 5 hours away. They go to Final Flight, they come to Discovery Park, and it's two great partners, you know, that it's a win-win for all of us.
That's what I was just getting ready to ask you. Do you know approximately how many people do y'all serve a year in person?
I need to track that a little better more often, you know, and have that number. But we have a lot of people that drive, you know, 5, 6 hours away just to come to these two locations and to our community and as well as to other merchants in town. Just because they can hit a lot in a day's time, and it's a good little getaway. And like I said, they can go online and buy those items, but I love shopping online myself, but I miss out on, if I know there's a place within an hour or two that I can go and see a vast amount of inventory and spend some time shopping, it kind of scratches an itch for me that I enjoy shopping.
Right. Well, along with the pendulum swinging to online shopping, it's also swung to shoppertainment.
That's right.
Where people love to go in and spend hours being entertained by the shopping experience. And, you know, I don't duck hunt. I haven't yet. I'm waiting for you to take me. But
we can handle that.
Even though you still, it's packed with stuff that was fascinating just to look through. And, you know, I love the decoys and the calls. And it's like an experience to go in there.
And I mean, me being one of the owners, I mean, I catch myself. I mean, literally, it's almost a couple times a week that I just go shopping. Mm-hmm. You know, I may go in the flashlight department, doesn't matter, and look and think, well, that's a neat little hat, you know, light that clips on your hat or this and that. And just, and the next thing I know, you know, I'm engaged and I'm having fun and I'm enjoying that. And if I get home at night, if I'm online, you just don't, those shopping experiences, it just doesn't. So to me personally, there's a fulfillment out of see it, feel it, touch it, experience it.
Well, there's also a camaraderie there that I see when I've been there and seen people shopping and interacting with the sales staff. And, you know, it's a lot of fun. What were the items that you guys very first, or what were the first items in that trailer that you were finding?
You know, a decoy company that I still actually work with, Higdon Outdoors, Higdon Decoys, Tim Grounds Calls, Duck Commander Products, they were way before the Duck Dynasty days. You know, they were almost like family to us. They entrusted us, and we would set up for shows for them, the Robertson family and everything. But those were kind of the main ones that got started, where they would send us some products, and you know, some of them we were just on consignment, you know, and they entrusted us, they knew of our family, and they were just, you know, at the time we were kind of strangers. We had some different, you know, common acquaintances, but they put a lot of trust in us, but I mean, we've never forgotten that.
Well, I was going to ask you, how did they get their own show and you didn't? Did you not have a beard?
Do
you need a beard to do that?
It's funny because, you know, knowing them well, and when I first watched the pilot of Duck Dynasty, and of course, we knew this was going for 2 years, you know, and I could see all this play out. But when I first saw it air, it was such a feel-good moment for a great family, mm-hmm. that I knew where their heart was.
Yeah.
You know, and to see that, and you talk about people that are just really true, and I thought, man, this is good. And they've been times, you know, when they've spoken in town that always stayed at our lodge and this and that, and we've got some really good stories and jokes. So to see that family get to where they are today, it's a great success story.
And do they still come?
They do. We stay in contact, and I was actually one of our marketing managers was down there and hunted with them this year.
Okay,
and
great.
A couple guys and I was down there last year as well, and we all went out to dinner. So they're just a great family. So you
guys are definitely an attractor for the hunting crowd. What do you find when people come here from out of town who are on their way to maybe Reelfoot Lake to go duck hunting, or what is the thing you guys sell the most of? What is your number one seller?
You know, we do a lot of apparel, and we do a lot of obviously hunting apparel, but we do a lot of just outdoor lifestyle apparel. You know, your brands like Columbia and Under Armour and Patagonia and those things that don't necessarily have to be a hunter to appeal to. So, and a lot of those neutral colors, those real tonal style colors and outdoor colors are really good. And those companies are big for us. But we do a lot with, from a decoy side, we do a lot with Higdon, obviously. We do a lot with Bandit and Drake. So there's a lot of good companies, you know, that we do. But apparel would probably say number one, just because it appeals to a large demographic.
So now let's rewind and go back to the beginning. Tell me about how you grew up, where you grew up, and when did you pick up your first duck call?
Oh, man, that was, I guess when I was just big enough to walk and drive my parents crazy and brothers crazy. But like I said, being from an ag community and from a farming household, and we had farm ground that we hunted on in the fall and winter months, growing up not hunting in my household and my community kind of was, it was almost like a sin. If you didn't go duck hunting every single day, it was like, what'd you miss? What was wrong? Why'd you sleep in? And you felt bad about it. So I grew up in that household, especially my older brothers. They were the ones that got me going and got me hunting and we even, in a 60-day duck season when I was, before I could even drive, I was riding with my brother to the duck blind, and then having to get a ride to school at 7:45, 8 o'clock. And then when I started driving, I could do it more frequently because I had my own car. But I mean, we were duck hunting every single day in a 60-day duck season. You didn't miss a day. I mean, it was like, you got to go duck hunting even
starting
when they're at school.
What age?
Oh, that was probably when I was 14, 15 years old.
Wow. Yeah.
And then it's just a way of life for us. We didn't know any different. And then when you get older, you get a little more responsibilities, you get jobs and this and that. There's kind of times that you have to, you obviously have, that takes priority, especially with kids and stuff like that. But you didn't know any different. And I would started that. And when I was in high school, I was actually a junior in high school. And I wanted to get into contest calling, but I remember when I was a senior in high school, my parents were watching the 10 o'clock news, and I was supposed to be in bed. We're all, going to bed. And I remember talking to them and telling them, if crazy idea, if I could win this goose calling contest, if I could become good in these contests, let's just say I won the world. If that would stamp my resume to where I was recognizable in the outdoor industry, well, maybe that would allow me to be a leg up on other people looking for employment opportunities in the hunting industry. So if I go to an Avery Outdoors or a Higdon Outdoor or whatever, those companies, and knock on their door, maybe if they already know of my name because I won a world title or won this, as crazy of an idea as that sounds, that was kind of the path that I went down.
Mm-hmm.
And that was in 98 or 97. I went to the world in 98, first year, and I mean, I come in probably the bottom five. It was horrible,
And so for somebody like me who has never, I've never called a goose,
yeah.
Talk me through just a little bit of the process or what,
okay.
what do you use?
I mean, you're using an instrument, and in layman's terms, a duck or goose call is no different than a musical instrument. Where it lacks is from a scripted standpoint and sheet music standpoint, where in music terms, and I was fortunate to go through Union City High School, and I was in the band, and I was huge in percussion. Like, I had an awesome mentors and teachers that taught me a lot about percussion, and so that's what I was really going to go to college in percussion and looked at different things, and the hunting pulled me in a different direction. But with that musical background and what, music has a standard. There's a standardization of writing notes to sheet music and stuff like that, where calling doesn't. It just hasn't evolved that much. But I wanted to evolve it to that route. So me putting a routine together, I would try to write sheet music for a goose calling routine, as crazy as that sounded, just to have a standard where I could have some consistency built up. So when you're doing a goose calling routine, I mean, it's like you're kind of out in the wild, but you simulate a scenario. Like if you see a flock of geese at a distance, you bring them in. If they're going away, there's certain comeback calls. And the last thing is if they were landing in your decoys. And all that's within a minute and a half standpoint. So within that framework, there's a lot of psychological aspects that I've did myself. And there's a lot of people that I've helped coach and stuff even today, that there's a lot of things that you can do and all that to prepare yourself to where the judges that are judging you are there's five judges. They take a cumulative score. They throw out the high and throw out the low, so they take the middle three average. Each judge, they cannot talk to each other. They're behind a curtain. They don't know who's calling. So they're only going off the element of sound. So with that said, when they do that, there's different things that I learned because of that musical background that applied it to from a calling routine. It's no different than a good song. A good song becomes a hit because it has a good chorus and it flows well. Same thing in a routine format. When a judge is only going off the element of sound only, it needs to have a good chorus. It needs to have a good flow. So there's certain things in there to do that I applied from a musical background to that and kind of kind of, I guess, was successful with it, and we're still doing pretty decent today.
So you walk in, you're, you know, 14, 15, 16 years old, and you're competing. Are you competing against people who've been doing it for 50 years? Or, and were there attitudes from these
people?
I've had some interesting, and I'm
kind of person that I've just tried to be, and I teach my kids, just to be extremely humble to everybody, you know, and respect. And interesting, I had a judge one time, there was a particular note I was doing on a goose call, and they call it a spit note. It's just a real short cluck, and it is unbelievably goosey and this and that. And I had a judge in Great Bend, Kansas, and his exact quote was after the contest, and I ended up winning the contest, but he scored me horrible on this one note. And his exact quote was, "Well, son, in 30 years of goose hunting, I never heard a goose do that." Of course, the son part with me, and I was 18 years old, it kind of hit me the wrong way. And he was a very nice, respectful man. So I just said, "Sir, and for the betterment of the sport, I would like to send you some live audio of this." And he's like, "Absolutely." And he was very receptive. So I went home and pulled up some old, this is back in cassette tape days.
Yeah.
So I pulled some cassette tapes up and sent him some, and he sent me a letter back thanking, and we had a great relationship. But there's some little bit of, you know, well, who's this young guy, you know, this and that. And I get it. I mean, I get that, but I wanted to prove myself and let the results speak for itself rather than be trying to convince people otherwise. So.
And then you started winning more and more frequently, obviously. And this is no different than any other subculture of people who are passionate about, you know. So you essentially became, you know, a superstar in this arena. What did it cause you any kind of challenges as a young man trying to grow up to suddenly be so successful and at the height of something like this?
You know, yes and no. I mean, it was there were some. I don't want to say stigmas. People would, just because of what you won, would put you up on a little bit of a pedestal that, in my opinion, is undeserving. You know, granted, those titles will go with me to my grave, but for the most part, I tell the guys, you know, that great long intro and introduction is great, but I'm just a country boy from West Tennessee and, you know, son to my mother was a librarian, my father was a farmer, and I'm no different than anybody else. And that's kind of the way I prefer it to be. But with that said, you know, extremely humble. With the guys that are calling in contests now that I help and do all that, they're the same way, and they're doing the right things, and it's just a great, you know, great environment to be around.
So do you not compete anymore?
I don't. Okay. I don't. I kind of live my contest days vicariously through a couple other individuals.
Okay.
And one particular guy works for our call company, and he was 2 years ago. I said, "You're going to win the world," you know, and he was probably a top 6, 7, 8 caller, and the first year he went back, you know, he come in second, and then this past year he won. So to me, that was a great feel-good moment, and give him, listen, all the credit, because when you have a person that's, this is what I told him, I said, "You're extremely," Kyle Jones is his name, I said, "You're extremely talented, but if we put mine and your head together, we're going to be better than any of us if we were just alone. Just because of what I say doesn't mean it's right. But there's a pretty good prescription that we've developed through the guys that when we've won, you know, world titles and done this and that. So if you can take 20% of what I say and then you take the rest of what you implement and what you know, you're going to become unstoppable." And wow. And it's just kind of like a Bill Belichick, Tom Brady combination, you know, and it creates an organization. And the funny thing is Kyle is doing this for, there's another kid, our call company won the junior world title as well. And there's another kid, Luke White from Paducah, Kentucky, that Kyle is that mentor for him, just teaching the same things, the same areas, how to act. And it's just a great to sit back on the sidelines and watch all this play out. And they're great, humble men that are doing good things in the outdoor industry. So
now I'm going to go to some of these. You're talking to me into being an audience. Where do these take place?
Well, the world is in Easton, Maryland. It's along with the Waterfowl Festival, and it's a huge nonprofit festival that they do. And the thing about the Waterfowl Festival in Easton, it's a big art festival. So it's very classy. I mean, the downtown streets of Easton are shut down. There's the brick streets and the little bitty shops and the art shops, and it's a very classy event, and you know, and they have these calling contests, so that's kind of where they host. But I always tell people, I said, you know, it's, and even when my wife, when we met and started dating, I said pardon the term, but it's kind of like a little redneck sport, you know, I mean, we're blowing a bird whistle in a sense. I said, but for me, I want to become a better hunter, I want to become a better caller, and I wanted to go that route just to open up doors in the outdoor industry. And since then, it's helped that. It's helped us with Final Flight, you know, to help get going there. And then as well as my career with the other stuff that I do with Hignan and our call company.
So once you originally started winning all these prizes, it wasn't long, I'm assuming, before the national brands came to
That's correct.
Sponsors.
That's correct. And you know, just because you know, if you win a title doesn't mean the door's going to come beat down. That's just not the case. You got to work. You got to roll your sleeves up and work. And I was fortunate to where I had some really good people around me that were in the industry that I relied on, that were kind of mentors of mine, that helped me along the way. And it did. It opened up some doors. I did some endorsement stuff with Avery Outdoors. I designed a layout blind for them that was highly successful in the market. And fortunately for them, they were getting in the goose hunting market, making goose hunting products. And I was the 21-year-old that we wanted to appeal to the 18 to 26, 27-year-old demographic of that guy that is very aggressive style hunting, that's not afraid to lay out there on the ground and these particular layout blinds. So I became the face of that movement in a sense because I just won the world title and I was a fairly young and doing all this stuff. So I was in it at the right time to where there was a lot of big sponsors involved and it really helped. So that's kind of how it goes, but you still got to roll your sleeves up and get to work.
Yeah. Oh, I bet. No, you'd be a great representative of any brand, well, even Discovery Park of America. Speaking of which, we actually, when you walk into the lobby to the left before you experience the whole rest of Discovery Park of America, you're there, your picture and a goose call there and a little bit about it. Do you remember
I do. When Discovery, I mean, goodness, this goes way back in the planning stages, with the Kirkland family and every, I mean, goodness, you talk about a community success story, the committees that helped bring in artifacts and bring in the displays and stuff like that was incredible. And I just kind of mentioned, I said, hey, the call I'm on the world with is just sitting on a shelf collecting dust. I mean, if it's local interest, then you know, absolutely. Put it on display there. It doesn't matter to me. And some people said, yeah, that would actually be a great because you're a local from Union City, and we'll put it on display. And so that is the exact call that I used in my whole career to call with. You know, so there's a lot of stories that go with that. There's a lot of miles and a lot of locations that it went to. And back then, goodness, I never would let it part from me. I mean, I always told, back when I was in college, I told the roommate, hey, if the house catches on fire, you grab this and let everything else burn. You know, it was just because there were some times that, you know, the more you use a particular call, that there's a piece of plastic in a reed that wears in a channel that you only get just the way it wears a certain way. Uh-huh. And so it worn in these little groove marks that you couldn't duplicate. And that was what was special for that you just, you know, if something happened to it, there's no way to duplicate it.
Yeah, so. Well, the nice thing about Discovery Park of America is that the mission is to inspire children and adults to see beyond. So, you know, just like this podcast, a lot of people will look at it and then move on. To hear the story behind it is fascinating to
it
me
is.
And to know all of the life and experiences that were behind that one little thing that's sitting behind a piece of glass is fascinating.
It is, and Discovery Park for us and our – I mean, granted, I'm spoiled because I'm from Union City and I lived here my whole life. But as a business with Final Flight, we look at a more successful Discovery Park means a more successful Final Flight. Mm-hmm. You know, and both of our customers go hand in hand. So what we try to do, even our back cover, we have a partner on the back cover of our catalog. You know, it's Discovery Park's location. And that goes out to 100,000 mailboxes every fall. You know, we go to shows and it's there. So we like to promote, like I said, the more successful DPA, the better. And what we found is advertising that, you have a lot of outdoorsmen that want to come to Final Flight, and they go with our catalog to the family and said, hey, you want to go to Discovery Park and all that? And, you know, and they're great. So they do both, and they
so
turn it into a weekend.
That's where those people in camouflage come from.
That's right. That's right. And they turn it into a weekend and a weekend getaway. And it's our business is no different with a lot of the lodges and outfitters, you know, around Reelfoot Lake and Tennessee River and stuff. You know, people come in to hunt. You know, they make it a destination for the whole family. Mm-hmm. If the wife or children don't want to go hunting with the husband, they come to Discovery Park. They go to the local shop. So it's a great – we're tickled to death to have it in our community.
Well, it's a great lead into what I was also curious about, which is running a big business. You guys really are a big business. Running that in a rural community What are its challenges and what are the good things around that?
Well, and that's a good point. So for us, there's some obvious challenges from a traffic count. You know, there's some hard numbers that you can say, well, on, you know, Highway 431, which is where we're located, you know, there's only a certain amount of traffic count that goes by. So if we're in a room and we're talking about building a new store, you're going to look for a high traffic count. You're going to, you know, that's just kind of common sense. For us, it's a little different in the outdoor industry. You know, a lot of your big destination stops, they kind of like to get outside of a city limits and become a destination themselves. We've looked into a lot of different things, even when we started, of moving different locations. But for us, you know, for example, we sell firearms, and we have a gunsmithing shop. And it's a little bit, and I thought about this too, there's some nostalgia that goes with it, of being out in the country community. If someone needs a shotgun worked on that their hunting gun broke, and they get out of the car with that, it's in a gun case, I have a feeling if they're getting out of their car and they're walking in, if it's more of a residential area or a city area, they may feel a little weird, you know, that. So being out in the country a little better, it seems like the customers are a little more comfortable going into a gunsmith shop and getting that worked on versus being in a urban environment. You know, there's a gas station across here. So I felt like our customer base, really, they like to go to those destination areas. And just be honest, a lot of our customers too, from a hunting standpoint, they're used to driving, you know, and we're not far, but if you look at the kind of even used to be the Cabela's model, and they're obviously highly successful, but they would always locate outside of an area and have a lot of property around them, and they would kind of, it would build up from there, but they would go out and have the customers come to them versus being in that downtown, you know, high traffic area. So that's the kind of the route that we went. And we're kind of, you know, built in a cornfield, and it was an old convenience store that my grandparents had, and we just kind of by default started there, and then we looked at moving into other locations, and it just kind of fell back on, we don't want to leave our customer base, you know, that likes to come out in the community and this and that. And granted, if you go to a city, you're, no matter which direction you go, north, south, east, or west, you're moving further away from some customer. Mm-hmm. So for us, I've already been cemented there. It's like, well, let's just go all in and just keep going where we're at. So.
Mm-hmm. And you can't build the kind of authenticity that you guys have there. I mean, it's a really special place.
That's true.
What's next? What's on the, you know, any news you want to break here?
Well, I would love to have, nothing. We're keeping on. Everything has been wonderful. We have switched over from a behind the scenes standpoint to a new software that we're from a point of sale that it all integrates. So, and then we actually launched a new website here last fall. So what that does is I encourage our local customers, you know, when you're at work, and if you're wanting a particular jacket or a particular flashlight or whatever it is, go to Final Flight. Go to the website. Pull it up real quick. You pull up your smartphone. If it shows up on that website, it is in stock and inventory on the shelf. Mm-hmm. And if you need to save time, if you're in Nashville and you're coming to Reelfoot Lake to hunt, you know, go to Final Flight. Check out, buy online, select in-store pickup for free freight. You don't have any freight. And then when you drive through, we'll have it waiting on you. And you just load you out, and then you're on your way. So those kind of things that with our new software allow us to do, and we can get really creative with doing store promotions and really track a lot with better reporting and stuff like that. So it allows us to do a lot of stuff that the customer won't see. But from the behind the scenes, we can really grow and offer more and be more of a convenience for them.
And then just from living in a rural community, I know you have a family, you know, you probably advocate, you know, you're both your extended family and your closer, everybody, a rural lifestyle, it probably contributes greatly to your life.
It does. And Faith Family Outdoors, you know, Final Flight Outfitters. And I kind of use that acronym I had to do a speech about a year or so ago. And I kind of threw that out there and I said, man, where did that come from? I said, well, I've been thinking about it for a while, but it really accurately describes our employees. You know, we're strong in faith. We're strong in family. We're strong in the outdoors. And FFO is Final Flight Outfitters. I said, that's kind of what I feel like that what stands for us. And we heavily rely on the University of Tennessee at Martin not only from a customer standpoint, but from an employee standpoint. Literally, men and women, when they enroll for fall semester, they will enroll in classes and come put a job application in. And the experience that we get from them, it's unbelievable, you know, and great work, great employees. And a lot of these men and women are very knowledgeable in the products, and they help. They're on top of current trends and on top of that. So what we do is we kind of we kind of throw them out there and let them succeed, let them teach us, and we'll take them to buying group shows. We'll take them, you know, as much as they want to do. And I always tell them, if you can stick with us for 4 years, and if we can afford to keep you at the end of that, you know, we want to keep you on board. If you want to go somewhere else in the industry, then I'm your number one fan. I'll make phone calls, I'll send email, whatever we got to do. And we've had, I mean, there's been a long list of people that have gone on that are outdoor reps, that are doing stuff with insurance, whatever field they want to get into. But without their help, goodness, there's no way we could be where we're at today.
That's all, you went from goose calls to changing the world.
Well,
honestly,
we're a family, and you know, like I said, that faith family outdoors, and that family, even though they may not be employed by us today, they're a strong family, you know, even now, and they know that. So we try to stay in contact with them too.
Excellent. Well, thank you for joining us. This has been amazing. You can shop with Final Flight Outfitters at their retail store here in Union City on your way to Discovery Park, or you can shop online at finalflight.net for all of your camouflage and other needs.
That's it.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Coming up, the infamous Andrew Gibson is going to sneak us backstage at Discovery Park of America, where we are going to learn something brand new.
All right. Thanks, Scott. Today, on the little nugget of information we've got on the Reelfoot Forward podcast, I've got a docent here from Discovery Park of America in the booth with us. It is Nate, and I don't even know your last name, Nate. Introduce yourself.
I'm Nate Newland. I'm a docent here at Discovery Park. I've been here for just a few months. I graduated last year with a degree in geology. My passion is in fossils, which is what we're going to talk about today, pretty much.
And I do love some fossils. Now, what's the official title of this?
The Paleontological Heritage of West Tennessee.
What he said.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah, that's that. Not going to repeat that.
Just paleontology with ickle on the end. So.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I'm not even going to try it. I will butcher it, and then I'll be made fun of. We're not even going to go there. So what is that?
So, like you, I grew up in West Tennessee, and as a child, when I thought of fossils, I thought of dinosaurs, like any child would. But there's actually so much more to our planet's history than that, and especially in West Tennessee, where we didn't have things like that, there is a tremendous amount of heritage, a tremendous amount of material that no one knows about, just because it's never talked about. It's overlooked in favor of things like dinosaurs. One thing that's pretty important to us in West Tennessee is the Coon Creek Formation, which is actually a world-famous fossil site. But did you hear about that growing up around
here? No, I definitely didn't hear about Coon Creek growing up. And where is Coon Creek, actually?
The formation stretches along the Tennessee River from about Parsons south to around the Mississippi border. But specifically, the Coon Creek Science Center, which is where most of the fossils come from, is around Adamsville, so about halfway between Enville and Adamsville, Tennessee.
Have you personally been there?
Many, many times.
Many times. And what do you do while you're there? Can you go into detail about that?
Yeah, so Coon Creek is pretty unique in a lot of ways. And in one sense, in one of those senses, it's because the matrix, which is the rock around it, is so soft that you can just brush it away with your bare hands, pretty much, or with a light brush. Whereas, you know, most time rock is pretty hard and you have to kind of chisel it away. So that makes it an amateur's paradise, because you can go out there, school groups go out there, and they can take home fossils that are pretty important to our area.
And so what kind of fossils are we finding here? Are we finding like sea life, or, you know?
Yes. So most of it is shallow marine. So stuff you would find in kind of like a coral reef setting today. Most of these fossils are invertebrates, which means animals that didn't have backbones. So like mostly clams, snails, what organisms that resemble what we would call a squid today. These things called scaphopods, oysters, scallops. But there are a few vertebrates like plesiosaurs and mosasaurs, which are on display here at DPA.
So you'd find like mosasaurs there. And what was the other one you said?
Plesiosaurs.
And do we have that on display here at Discovery Park? And can you describe that one to me? What does that one look like?
So the plesiosaur, it looks like a long-necked dinosaur, but with fins instead of legs.
Oh, okay, cool.
So the thing out there that's fighting with the mosasaur.
Okay, all right, I got that. So just tell me more about I guess, how these fossils developed here in West Tennessee.
Right.
I mean, you know, we're talking sea animals, right? Essentially, mm-hmm. sea creatures. How did they get to West Tennessee, or you know?
So around the time that the Coon Creek Formation was being deposited, the coastline was actually up around Nashville. The sea level was much higher. It kind of gives us an idea of what could happen in the future. But anyway, so this was just offshore, maybe 10, 20, 30 miles offshore. And so still fairly shallow, and shallow enough where when storms came in, they could kick up sediment and basically deposit it in one big bank. And when it did that, that's perfect mode for preservation for fossils. And Coon Creek, especially around Coon Creek Science Center, is one of the best examples in the world of that kind of scenario. Coon Creek is actually what we would call a Lagerstätte, which is...
I'm sorry?
A Lagerstätte.
It's yeah, you're going to have to quit with these big words, mate.
But it basically means there's just so much there that it's just like pouring out of the walls of the creek. And even more specifically, it's a Lagerstätte conservaten, which there are only a few of those in the world. It basically means like the mother load of fossils. There's just so much there, and it's so important.
And that's nestled here in West Tennessee, correct?
Yes.
Well, that's really fascinating. Yeah, I wish growing up, you know, I would have known of these, mm-hmm. You know, instances where I could go out and you know, situations where I could go look for fossils myself. That being said, with it being such a big deal, is it just school kids going and take advantage of this, or are there colleges that go out, or are there actual archaeologists that go and spend a lot of time there, or has that kind of been the big stuff kind of been picked through, and what's left is kind of the you know, not so important things? I hate saying that because yeah. it's still important, but you know, has the Mosasaurus kind of moseyed on along?
Well. To answer that last question, not at all. It's a pretty limitless amount of material. The amount that has actually been gone through is minuscule compared to what is actually there. I'd have no doubt that as you walk across the property there near the creek, you're walking across mosasaurs, plesiosaurs, who knows what else. What was your other question before that?
Are there any, like, is it just school kids taking advantage of this,
no.
or are there universities and colleges, or, you know, big right. archaeologists
so
that go out?
Until recently, the Science Center itself was owned by the Coon Creek family of museums, and they have what they call members' days, where the members of the museum would go and basically have a dig once or twice a year. I worked at those events, which is how I know about those, as well as school groups, basically. And Dr. Gibson at UT Martin would take groups almost every weekend for his classes.
Well, that's really fascinating. Nate, I think at a later episode, maybe we can talk about what exactly you did while you were there. Like, what's the procedure of being mm-hmm. an archaeologist and kind of
paleontologist.
Thank you. Sorry about that.
There's another episode too.
That is another episode. Yes. We can go in the difference in the details there. So, all right, guys, well, thank you so much. This is Andrew Gibson, and we appreciate you listening to the Reelfoot Forward podcast.
Thank you for listening to Reelfoot Forward. If you enjoyed this podcast, please be sure to subscribe, rate, and leave a review on iTunes or wherever you may be listening. Plan your own adventure to see beyond at Discovery Park of America by visiting discoveryparkofamerica.com. Be sure to also follow us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter for the latest updates.